Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Faria Idris Official. The Foreign Office of Pakistan is repeatedly denying the presence of any US military or airbase in Pakistan, stating that any speculation is baseless and irresponsible and should be avoided. In a statement which has been issued by Foreign Office, spokesperson Zahid Hafiz Chaudhry clearly said that all of these fabricated news are being denied. Quote unquote, he said, there is no US military or air base in Pakistan, nor was any such proposal envisaged. Any speculation on this account is baseless and irresponsible and should be avoided. Speaking about the matter, while giving a policy statement in the upper house, Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi also said that the reports regarding US bases in Pakistan are baseless. He said, the foreign minister, that he wants to clarify that Pakistan will neither allow any drone nor will this be allowed, that any American base will be established here in Pakistan. His words, quote unquote, Pakistan is in safe hands. This is what the foreign minister said. However, the problem is that there are persistent reports which are emerging from the United States. A few days ago, it was the New York Times in their article, CIA Scrambles for New Approach in Afghanistan. This article says that CIA Director William J. Burns recently made an unannounced visit to Islamabad to meet the military and political leadership here in this regard. This article also suggests that Pakistan is not the only option that they are looking at. American officials are also saying that Defense Secretary Lloyd J. Austin has had frequent calls with the Pakistan military chief about getting the country's help for future U.S. operations in Afghanistan. Today, again, the question of these bases was raised at a briefing at the White House. And let's see how the question was answered.
Can you bring us up to speed on where are the negotiations with Pakistan and would the United States like to have a drone base in Pakistan?
So I'm not going to get into the details of our negotiations with Pakistan. I will only say this. We have had constructive discussions in the military, intelligence, and diplomatic channels with Pakistan about the future of America's capabilities to ensure that Afghanistan never again becomes a base from which Al-Qaeda or ISIS or any other terrorist group can attack the United States. And what I will say is that we are talking to a wide range of countries.
Today, again, in my program, I raised this question to Shavkat Mahmood, who is the minister of the government. He was a bit adamant in answering because he said that everyone has answered. Why do you people keep on asking us this question again and again? And he said, we are very clear. And if this makes any more certainty that Pakistan is not going to give any U.S. bases to U.S. I'm being joined here by Dr. Maria Sultan. Thank you so much for
being here.
Director Sasi, and an intellectual and an academic. Thank you so much for joining us here. Dr. Maria, why is America talking about it again and again? I know Pakistani media is discussing this, but most of the sources of these stories are coming from Washington. There was this article in the New York Times, then the question is being asked at the State Department. What is going on?
Well, I think at the heart of it lies the central question which everybody has asked about the U.S.-Afghan war. What is the notion of victory? And how do you achieve that notion of victory? And when we look at the United States looking for options in the region for its military bases, it's more to do with keeping its options open in terms of military connectivity and using select kinetic operations. But the problem here is this, that after 20 years long war in Afghanistan, Afghanistan is still not settled. Violence is still becoming a new reality, and which is soon going to become the reality for Afghanistan, unfortunately, because the peace process has not picked up under the Biden administration that people had hoped. It has not concluded. And the primary reason for that is that the U.S. establishment would still like to keep its options open if, you know, any kind of threat would they assimilate, which would what they think could assimilate
You're saying is there's a political side to it, and then there's the establishment of the military side
I
to
think
it. Politically, they felt pressurized to give the deadline of September 11,
actually,
but military is advising otherwise.
Actually,
it seems very correct, but because this is what the article suggests here also.
Actually, what they're trying to do is this, that militarily, of course, they want to bring their boys home. That's exactly what Washington is trying to do. Unfortunately, they won every battle in Afghanistan and lost the war. You can't keep on changing your war objectives States and declare victory in the hope that this is what the people wanted and this is what was expected.
Can we say that America has not won this war? Can we say this?
We can definitely say that, because if winning the war was to ensure, what were your goals and targets? You know, it's the notion of victory's concept, which I said. If the notion of victory was based that Afghan territory will not be used for furthering terrorist attacks in other regional countries or remain an international, you know, a threat to international security, unfortunately, that's still on the table.
Right.
We continue to face, as a neighboring country, we continue to face threats from Afghanistan on daily basis. Terror threats, we have seen increased incidents of not only terror groups aligning in Afghanistan, but we've also seen Afghan territory being used against us.
Right.
So that's just Pakistan.
If you'll allow me, I quickly want to read this part, because you mentioned about the political and the military side of it, because in this article in the New York Times, it says that the CIA chief had warned the parliament that we will lose footprint in Afghanistan. If I should read the exact point, it says, William Burns, the CIA director, has acknowledged the challenge the agency faces, which will be the agency now faces. When the time comes for the U.S. military to withdraw, the U.S. government's ability to collect and act on threats will diminish, he told senators in April. That is simply a fact. So is United States concerned about this?
I think this is a bigger question which the U.S. Congress must ask its people and its intelligence agencies and its military. They are going to be funding the Afghan National Army almost annually, or maybe with a budget of $4.2 billion. So this basically means, what training did you level? What kind of state have you left the Afghan National Army that they're incapable of providing that necessary footprint and hold which the Central Intelligence Agency would require? One. Number two, and does the CIA actually need a safe haven? And if they need that safe haven, why is it that the Afghan National Army can't do that for them? Why is it that other regional allies in this region, particularly India,
could be India.
India, yes. Because they've invested very strategically in India over the last 2 decades.
So why? That's my question to you. Why is there never a question India giving any basis
I think the problem is the blowback. The problem is not the fact that they want to take kinetic operations, so there is any doubt in their mind that Hitlerkin operations will go on. Because if you look at the BC agreement, which you look at the bilateral security agreements between United States and the Afghan government, you understand that hit and kill operations will continue. You understand that counter-terror attacks will continue. The question is that earlier it was a NATO force, it was EU-backed force, it was U.S. military, which was providing the traction for these IBOs, the intelligence-based operations. Now, once that force will move away, the question is, what will the terrorists hitting back? Either the ANA, the Afghan government, or those military bases which will be supporting and protecting the CIA assets, or CIA itself, or CIA operations.
Can I quickly again read from the article, because we want to keep on board what the American think tanks are saying. So the New York Times is also saying, recent CIA and military intelligence reports on Afghanistan have been increasingly pessimistic. That would be from the US point of view. They have highlighted gains by the Taliban and other militant groups in the south and east, like you were saying, and warned that Kabul could fall to the Taliban within years and return to becoming a safe haven for militants bent on striking the West. According to several people familiar with the assessments, what is your feedback on this fear?
I think there are three things which have to be seen in Afghanistan. First is, this is not the Afghanistan of the one which United States encountered in 9/11.
And it's not the America. It's not the same
No,
United
it's not
States
the same
well.
America. But the question is, will the world actually take recognition of the fact that the 20-year support to the Afghan national government has not actually yielded in an effective government. It has not yielded in them actually controlling their territory. You know, out of multiple provinces in Afghanistan, multiple provinces are out of control of the Afghan government. You can easily say 70%, in certain cases 80%
right.
of the territory is not in their control. In certain cases, you know, it's even argued that 90% are areas of influence of the Taliban. Secondly, if you will disenfranchise a majority on the basis of ethnicity, and then you will not allow in a tribal system for them to be empowered, then you will have fights.
Right.
And then on top of that, like I said, it's not the 9/11 Afghanistan. So now you have got 20-year war veteran, war veterans in Afghanistan, the terror groups, other
additional
groups which have been fighting.
Years because they were already war veterans.
Secondly, these are the groups which have seen nothing but 20 years of war. This is a generation grown up in war. Number three, this is a generation which has grown up with the American military and American institutions actually funding the back end war. And when by that I mean they looked the other way when it came to Afghanistan becoming the global transit as well as the global producer of global opium trade. Mm. We are talking about almost $89 billion a year just past. Transit alone from Pakistan is 44%.
Isn't this a flashback to 90s? Aren't these the same questions that were being raised at
I think
time?
It is a bigger question mark because earlier you did not have warlords, we did not have, you know, people invested so much into these, you know, big multi-billion dollar war. You did have the United States supporting the Taliban and the Mujahideen then of one part of the war. You did not see them actually present in the scenario. Now once they are going to go, there's going to be a huge power vacuum. But the question here is that you have got in this region, India as your regional ally, you have got them as your intelligence partner, you've signed BICA with them, you've signed military interoperable MOUs, you've got Lima with them, you've signed multiple defense MOUs, which indicate that an American army can very easily become interoperable with the Indian army. In this case, Indian intelligence and American intelligence would also be working together. So the real question is why you don't want to use that as a regional base, because if a UAV flies from an Indian base or it flies from Pakistan, it's the same. If it can fight from North Virginia down here or it flies from some other base, the question really is that if they want to attack terror groups from Pakistan without Pakistan's knowledge, then it means we take the next front. And I don't think so the people of Pakistan or this region, or for that matter, we are ready to take on the third counter-terror war of the United States.
So there's a clear no from Pakistan's
side? I think what Pakistan has said is very appropriate. We said that, okay, if this is a question, then the framework will be, what will be the framework of cooperation? Will it mean that you will also hit all terrorists? And if it means all terrorists, that means the Tehrike, Taliban, Pakistan would also be hit, because according to us, that's a terror group.
They are the terrorists.
BLA
yes.
is a terror group which is operating over there. We will expect Afghan, supported ANA supported
We've done
elements.
This in the past. No, we do give our air base. Let's say, hypothetically, what are the repercussions?
So the first repercussion would be that you will be fighting your military and your infrastructure will be hit back by the third wave. Second impact will be that there will be a tri-border war. You know, the Afghan war would be brought into your region. We have paid a huge price, or military or people have paid a huge price to clear Fatah. We have cleared a huge price, just to create the menace what we have faced in Balochistan to come to some cognizance. People of Pakistan need development. We are not about to fight a war which America has fought for the last 20 years and not won. They have won the battles and lost the war. And this is the reality. So if they want to now win the war and they have invested in regional countries, they want to do quad exercises with India, they want to invest intelligence cooperation with India, then that should be their natural ally.
So let's take a look at Afghanistan from Afghanistan's perspective, because there have been warnings from Taliban, from other officials, Afghan officials also, regarding this news. If this happens again, and I know there's a clear no from the Pakistani government, but let's say if there are bases operating, Americans operating from Pakistani bases, where does Pakistan stand with Afghanistan then?
The fact of the matter is this, that it's not our war.
It is not our war.
It is America's war.
And we have realized it.
And I think we have realized it very well. We have our own counter-terror war to deal with. We have said very clearly that Afghan peace process would be led by the Afghans, owned by the Afghans, and developed by them. It should be Afghan-led and Afghan-owned. So if it is going to be Afghan-led and Afghan-owned, and we have been playing a very constructive role in the region for the peacemakers, for the power brokers, for bringing all negotiating parties, all warring factions to the negotiating table. Yes. So now you want us, our roles to be reversed, and you want us to pick up and do the dirty work.
Once
and that
again.
Also, no. If you do this, what does Pakistan gain?
No,
what
past.
Does Pakistan gain? A $6 billion tranche from IMF, it's not worth it. We gave the G-locks, we closed the G-locks after NATO supply routes were also stopped. Why? Because we saw an irregular, unsanctioned, illegal attack on Pakistani military officers and military post in Salalah.
So the most important question, I come to the last part of our conversation. Will U.S. really leave Afghanistan?
Of course not. That goes without saying. The only thing is the character of war will change, the nature of war will change, and the players would change.
So it will leave physically, but will be here spiritually.
No, I don't think so. They will leave physically. It's the American military which is leaving. Hmm. It's not the American intelligence which is leaving. And that is why the CIA...
That is very clearly stated here, and that is why
the CIA seems to be pitching its case for having more purview. The fact remains that they have also been the power brokers for the Afghan government and the Afghan governance structures.
Yes.
So the real question I think the people need to ask, especially in the United States and international community, including the NATO partners, is that where were these investments actually made? Hmm. That now the structures, the trainings are unable to hold the threat, unable to hold the peace. So if they're unable to hold the peace, you can't expect countries which you have targeted.
Very interesting debate, Dr. Maya. I'm afraid you have to
help fill up that gap.
Cut it here. Thank you so much, Dr. Maya Sultan. One thing she said is extremely important, and we see that that is about other options that U.S. can explore, being India at the top. I'm going to read from New York Times again. It says diplomats are also exploring the option of regaining access to bases in former Soviet republics that were used for Afghanistan war. However, they also are very well aware that this will not be a very practical option. But as Dr. Maya Sultan said, why not India then? We will keep you updated in the coming days, but it seems like that the war is not over. Take care of yourself.